From the Lower Colorado River Authority, this is Wavelength.
Hi everyone, and welcome to the September edition of Wavelength. You know, a couple of months ago when the city of Austin announced they might be interested in selling off their electric system, it stirred a debate all across the state. And although a final decision may be a long way off, it has many utility companies pondering their options if the city should decide to sell. And of course, the LCRA has entered the equation, and for a number of good reasons. First, we're partners with the city at the Tom Miller Dam and have been since the 40s. And we're also partners with them at the Fayette Power Project in LaGrange. So where does all of this leave LCRA? We asked LCRA General Manager Mark Rose.
So you've seen me jumping out there and doing a few things that are a little bit more outspoken in the Austin market than I've done in the past, but you know, we have a right to represent our interest, and we also have a genuine concern about what our partner does in the future. I would hope that Austin would decide not to go down the road of looking at selling their utility now, deciding philosophically that there's a strong rationale for maintaining a community-owned system, figuring out on their own independently what it is they need to do to be competitive, and then if that provides some additional partnerships with us, great. If it doesn't, fine. There'll be a competitive utility in the region, there'll be more competition, they'll be happy, we'll be happy, our customers will be happy, the world will be round.
At the August board meeting, directors caught Mark Rose by surprise when they approved a resolution honoring him on his fifth anniversary as general manager.
And whereas the exceptional rating for the Colorado River downstream of Austin exemplifies his exceptional drive to clean up the river and make it swimmable and fishable, and whereas even though a young man, he embraces the history of the LCRA as the foundation of his vision of LCRA's mission now and in the next century. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Lower Colorado River Authority Board of Directors expresses its best wishes to Mark for his achievements, his foresight, his positive attitude, and unfailing good humor.
The board also approved a resolution which creates a natural science laboratory in Llano County. The LCRA purchased this 1,016-acre tract of land along the Llano River in August, and it will be used as a living environmental research area.
A natural science laboratory is a place for applied research, for field days. It is a place where the land managers in a region can come together and learn what works, what is successful in terms of implementing conservation techniques, soil and water conservation and wildlife being the principal objectives at a natural science laboratory. And I guess also environmental education has got to be stressed. Certainly we do feature opportunities for schools, high schools, colleges, universities to do research and to both generate information and also to share that information with the land managers in that region.
This Llano site will be the third natural science lab in LCRA's territory. A citizens advisory committee will be formed in Llano County in the near future to help LCRA plan for the use of this unique resource.
The LCRA's three new board members, Fred Henneke, Steve Rivers, and Peter Pinkoffs, have had quite a learning curve to overcome since their appointments. And although they've spent a lot of time reading about the organization, it's not quite the same as seeing things for yourself. So that's exactly what they did. The three new directors visited a number of facilities, and we caught up with them at the Sim Gideon Power Plant in Bastrop, where plant manager Tommy Higgins led them through the turbine deck and the control room. Later, they visited the rail car facility in Smithville, where the LCRA maintains more than 1,300 coal cars. At the end of the day, we asked each of the men what their impressions were.
Well, I wasn't very familiar with LCRA since I live over in the hill country and I'm not on the Colorado River. and the expansion, the breadth and the depth of the organization is unbelievable, and we've just touched the surface of it. You think of the LCRA, and first of all you think of the river, but then you find out it's a major electric supplier, sixth largest in the state, and then you learn about the white wastewater facilities, and you visit the plants, and you go to the lakes, and you just see that it's an unbelievable organization that is an example of how government can work for the benefit of the people.
It looks like we're much more community involved at this time than say 15 years ago, and I very much support that. And we're also much more committed to the river, and I live on the river, and that's important to me. So I think if I have anything in this that I'm interested in, it's probably water quality and maybe. LCRA taking more of a positive role in that?
More than anything in the tours that I've been involved in so far, the orientation tours, I've just been impressed by the professionalism and the dedication of the LCRA employees. It's probably the most dedicated group of people that I've ever had the pleasure of meeting working with any company.
Back in February of 94, employees from the LCRA and the Texas Agricultural Extension Service installed this flume on the Alfred Findeisen farm in Bastrop County. The idea is to channel rainfall, which runs off the field, through the flume so an instrument package mounted on the side can measure flow rates and rainfall amounts and automatically gather samples. Scientists hope to use the information gathered here to help determine what effect different farming techniques have on non-point source pollution. Scores of area farmers and ranchers gathered at the farm recently for a field day sponsored by the LCRA, TNRCC, and the Bastrop County Extension Service. Farmers toured the demonstration project and received information about best management practices designed to keep agricultural chemicals such as fertilizer and pesticides on the fields and out of the waterways.
People interested in water quality don't want polluting constituents in the water, and agricultural people don't want the money that they spend putting those constituents on their field to go into the water either, because it's not doing them any good. So this is an excellent project for that.
Got interested in this project because I've been reading in the farm magazines where farmers are getting blamed for pollution from fertilizer and pesticides and insecticides. And the LCRA and the Extension Service contacted me along with the NRCC and asked me if I'd be interested in participating in a project of this magnitude. And I said I was very much interested in it to try to hopefully prove that farmers are not the cause of this type of pollution. If it is, well, then we need to change our practices.
Mr. and Mrs. Findeisen were presented an LCRA Environmental Award for their participation in this pilot project.
LCRA employees rolled up their sleeves once again for a very worthy cause. The annual blood drive at the General Office Complex was a big success. Company-wide, LCRA employees give hundreds of units of blood each year.
It didn't hurt a bit, not at all. I might do this again.
Officials at the Central Texas Blood Center say that these kinds of company blood drives are vital to meeting the demand for blood in this region.
Right now we're going to take you to a Central Texas community that's celebrating its centennial year. It was incorporated in 1895, and there were two things that were vital to the creation of this community. One was the railroad, the other, the Colorado River. Right now let's visit the community of Smithville.
In 1845, the Colorado River served a stream of commercial operations. Steam-powered boats hauled cotton and other agricultural products to market, and a ferry crisscrossed the river near the village of Old Smithville. The railroad arrived in 1887, bringing with it a major boom to the town, and Smithville grew up between the tracks and the river. Just a few years ago, Smithville was on the decline. The population was decreasing, many vacant buildings lined Main Street, and there just weren't any new jobs. Today, this community of 4,000 has really turned around. Main Street is bustling with activity, and many of the downtown buildings and Victorian homes have been beautifully restored. A brand new community hospital just opened its doors with 5 full-time and 11 part-time doctors. And according to fourth-term Mayor Vernon Richards, it has taken a total community effort.
We've made a lot of progress here in Smithville. Tremendous amount of progress. The town's rolling, doing very well, and of course when it's doing well, makes me feel better, makes the council feel better.
Last year, the city issued $6 million in new construction permits. That number exceeds the total for the last 50 years combined. The city electric crew worked late into the night and was back out this morning restoring service after a severe thunderstorm blew through, downing power lines, limbs, and taking the roof off of one Main Street business.
We had quite a few lines down. Most of it caused by lightning, and trees fell across several services in town, and got everybody restored in approximately about 3 to 4 hours at the most.
And within seconds, it seemed like people came from everywhere to offer every type of help. People were coming to check on EO Sharp. The water had run into the building to help clean up. It's just a community spirit that exists here in Smithville that you just can't find in most places. And we all feel really lucky to live here.
The Colorado River once again plays an important role in the quality of life here in Smithville. The river is clean again, and residents are drawn to its banks at the new Vernon Richards Riverbend Park. This 50-acre park has a lighted fishing pier, 19 RV sites, camping, 60 picnic tables, a pavilion, and facilities for large group outings. The park was created through a partnership between the LCRA, Texas Parks and Wildlife, and the city of Smithville.
I think it's another cornerstone as far as showing some emphasis as far as the river is concerned. We have a fishing pier. We have people out there fishing. And the fish that they catch, they can eat. And a few years ago, they couldn't do that.
I like to come in here almost every weekend. Almost any weekend you come out here, there's going to be a lot of people out here from families, volleyball courts, playing volleyball every weekend. There's a lot of activity out here.
This is the 100th anniversary of the founding of Smithville, and the celebration has been going on all year. Mayor Richards says the highlight of the year will be a reunion of all Smithville High School graduates to be held the last weekend in September.
If you are one of the thousands of people who enjoyed the 1991 celebration of the 50th anniversary of Tom Miller Dam, then you'll love what's coming up on September 24th. That's the day the Friends of the Colorado River Foundation are sponsoring Rock the River Clean. Entertainers such as Jerry Jeff Walker and Tish Hinojosa will help the foundation focus attention on the river. There will also be riverboat rides, dam tours, and a sand dam competition. The event will be held at the LCRA General Office Complex on Lake Austin Boulevard, and it's free to everyone. So come on by and help us rock the river clean September 24th.
It was 60 years ago that the Texas Legislature created the Lower Colorado River Authority. Now this month on Time Capsule, we're going to take a look back with someone who was there at the very beginning. The year was 1935. Governor Ma Ferguson had just signed the bill creating the LCRA, and with a $5,000 loan from the state, the new agency set up offices in the Littlefield Building on Congress Avenue. Chairman of the first LCRA Board of Directors, Roy Fry, hired a young woman from Burnett County named Gaynell King as one of the first employees of the agency. Mrs. King, now retired and living in Austin, remembers her first day on the job in 1935.
We're supposed to take some letters and take some dictation and whatnot, but no office, no typewriter. So they brought some typewriters in and put them in the windowsills. And the Littlefield Building has wide walls, you know. So I did my first dictation and worked at the typewriter standing up at the window.
The nation was still in the grips of the Great Depression, and jobs were scarce. Mrs. King remembers how thrilled she was to go to work for the LCRA.
I was making $135 a month. That was a lot of money back then, and I was so pleased to have it. And I think it just helped everyone's attitude about life, especially those of us who were young. We had gave us more incentive and to do and continue working and climbing a ladder.
Clarence McDonough was the first general manager of the LCRA, and Mrs. King says being around Mr. McDonough was like being in the presence of royalty.
In the boardroom, he was just elegance. He was just a wonderful person. Everyone admired him so much, but they didn't get out of line with him.
Of course, the primary focus of the newly created agency was to complete the construction of Buchanan Dam. And when Secretary of the Interior Harold Ickes came to Texas in 1937 to formally dedicate this massive new dam, Gaynell King was there.
All of us who were there and worked with the authority for any length of time felt like it was our own accomplishment, you know, and we were there to cheer it on and cheer the person who was dedicating it. And then we were always very fond of Congressman Buchanan. He would come in the office and he just took over. He liked the girls. He would always have something nice for us to eat or something nice to say to us.
Mrs. King says that the LCRA had an immediate and lasting effect on the entire region.
It just saved the whole Central Texas from the Depression and gave life, water, electricity, which is the life of the whole Central Texas now. Think about all those lakes now and not the retirement people and the irrigation, and I think it's been a great benefit to our country.
Mrs. King started somewhat of a tradition in her family by going to work for the LCRA. She had two brothers, John Wilburn and Jerry Daugherty, who followed in her footsteps. Two nephews, Keith and Ed Daugherty, work at the company today. She says she still keeps up with news of the LCRA and has a little advice for today's employees.
Well, I think I would tell them to do their very best at their job and be very proud of what they're doing, because it affects so many lives. What they're doing affects millions of people and into the future. Be proud of it.
Well, our old friend Tom Glenn's got a case of fall fever sitting down there in Smithville waiting for that first cold front to blow through, reminding us that fortunately August won't last forever. Here's Tom Glenn's postcard from Smithville.
Well, good afternoon. It's September in Smithville. A lot of good things are happening. Summer's almost over. Kids are all back in school. Football season's here, and our general manager's tacked on another 5 years to her proposed rate freeze. Of course, I like his style. You know, with an attitude like that, I'd like talking to moving into Smithville and opening him up a grocery store and a filling station. Of course, with this deregulation and competition, you know, I think Mark's got us in a good position to face the challenges of the future. Besides, we're not the first industry to be deregulated. I mean, they deregulated the airlines and the rail lines and the telephone companies. You know, if you remember back probably 40 years ago, a long distance telephone call from coast to coast would cost you probably $9.58. That same $9.58, you could have mailed 330 letters. Of course, a few years ago, that same phone call cost you about $1.20. For that, you could only mail about four letters. And the government wanted to investigate the phone company. I mean, my way of thinking, postage is still only 3 cents. That other 29 cents, I think that's just paying for storage. Well, we got our gain sharing checks last month, and I was pretty proud about that. And you know, a time when a lot of the industries and utilities are cutting back and downsizing, laying people off. I mean, the LCRA, we were able to have our bond rating upgraded and We were able to tack on another 5 years to a rate freeze all the way to the year 2005, and on top of that, pass out a pretty healthy gain sharing check. The way I look at it, you know, things just don't get much better than that. Well, speaking of gain sharing, I guess I better get on back to work. So this is old Supreme Commander saying all to you single folks out there, don't try to marry for money. Just hang around the rich folks and fall in love. We'll catch you next time.
Well, that's just about all of our time here on Wavelength. But before we go, we'd like to share with you a new feature here on the show. Each month from now on, at the end of the main program, we'll be including television news clips that have been recorded from the prior month. We hope you find them interesting. That's it for this edition of the show. We'll see you next month.
Austin's biggest electric customer is staying. Today, the city announced it's reached a long-term deal with the state of Texas to provide power to all state buildings. Last year, the state threatened to shop around for electricity, saying bills were too high. But Austin has agreed to give the state a series of rate reductions that total about $2 million a year.
Well, there are now about 50 million dead fish floating off the Texas shore near Matagorda Bay. Officials there say that the fish near where the Colorado River empties into the Gulf of Mexico are suffocating. Biologists say that they are dying from lack of oxygen. Apparently, tides aren't moving fast enough to increase the river and the oxygen flow.
What a sight.
Daybreak time now, 6:18, and if you're asked, what does the LCRA do, you first might answer, well, they run the Highland Lakes and they supply electricity.
Well, the Lower Colorado River Authority is also responsible for water and wastewater, parks and recreational facilities, and water quality. The LCRA works with the City of Austin to supply electricity and helps maintain our water quality. And to tell us more about what's that working relationship is Robert Kulik from the LCRA. Good morning, Robert. Thanks for being with us this morning.
Good morning, Christine, from the powerhouse at Tom Miller Dam.
Let's talk a little bit about electricity. The city owns Tom Miller Dam, but the LCRA runs it. How has that worked out so far?
Well, that relationship started in 1939 and has worked out very well. We operate the dam as along with five other dams, and to have a very integrated management of that system has worked out both for flood control and also for electric production.
I understand the LCRA recently received an award ranking you the sixth in the nation for community and investor-owned utilities. It ranked as the top public-owned wholesale utility. What are some of the criteria the LCRA was judged on?
Well, we're real proud of that ranking because it's the first time that all the utilities were ranked on an equal basis, on an equal footing. And for us to get that ranking, I think shows that we've not only got a good market, but we've got the right people in place, the right employees doing the right job, that we've got good financial indicators, but we also have a very good relationship with our customers. And that relationship is what people are looking for moving forward into an area of competition, because that's going to help
us out. The LCRA wants to manage the city's power company. Robert, do you know when that would happen or how that would work?
Well, the LCRA is a partner with the City of Austin right now, for instance, and has been since 1939 in the case of this powerhouse. And what we're talking about is increasing that relationship to the extent that the City of Austin wants us to. Right now, we supply about 40% of the city's non-nuclear energy, and we can do more if we want, if they want.
I think another great option. Robert, thank you so much for being with us. We'll talk to you again in the next half hour. The Lower Colorado River Authority is responsible for water and wastewater, parks and recreational facilities, water quality, and supplying the city with electricity. And tonight, there's a big board meeting. And to tell us more about that meeting and what's in the works for the future is Robert Kulik with the LCRA. Thank you for joining us this morning, Robert.
Thank you for having us. Our board meeting today will begin discussing some long-range financial plans and some other plans as we move forward into an area of competition.
Robert, one of your duties is water quality. How clean is the river right now?
One thing that's really good is that people should feel good about is that the City of Austin and the citizens of Austin have helped clean up the river. The river is now cleaner than it has been in the last 10 or 15 years. All parts of it are fishable.
Robert, can you explain real quickly, in a few words, how you generate electricity where you are?
Well, I'm standing on top of Unit 1, and to my left is Lake Austin, to my right is Town Lake, and as the waters pass between Lake Austin and the Town Lake, this unit here makes about 8 megawatts of electric power.
Amazing. And Robert, I understand you just recently got into the broadcast business. Can you quickly tell us a little bit about that?
The water that passes through here is also sometimes damaging, and in flood situations, we need to tell people exactly what's happening. So we've opened an AM radio at 1530 on your dial to provide weather information day in and day out. During about regular hours, it just has the regular broadcast, but during emergencies, we'll have emergency broadcasts.
Can you tell us a few of the topics being covered quickly at tonight's board meeting?
Well, tonight's board meeting will, and tomorrow, we'll be talking about some long-range financial plans. We'll be talking about some the way we operate our power plants and basically how we can partner with folks to operate those power plants better.
The powerful winds in West Texas are blowing power into some homes here in Austin. Take a look. This is the state's first wind power plant in the Delaware Mountains in West Texas. These huge wind turbines went online today. They're about 90 miles east of El Paso. The city of Austin is buying electricity from this plant, as is the Lower Colorado River Authority. The LCRA is one of the partners in building the plant.